All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503 back with the interview section. Here we got Dylan Reubenking in the building. What up, Dylan?
Hey, how's it going, Ryan? Thank you so much for having me, man.
Awesome, man. Love what you do over there. Thank you so much for joining us. I think this is a great time to chat about the Ducks. You guys are working with Max Torres, Ducks Digest, SI Now, the whole thing over there. I love what you've been doing. You've been putting in some great work, and got to love Max Torres. Give Max a shout out here.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Max is the man. He's been, you know, just grinding his tail off in between, you know, traveling and, you know, covering all these games and stuff like that. So, yeah, definitely got to put out a shout out. He's been phenomenal.
Well, he does a great job. Really impressed with him and his kind of vision of what he wants to do with this and whatnot. So all I'm trying to do is promote the brand as much as possible. So, Dylan, let's go ahead and jump right into it. We've got a brand new coaching staff. And obviously in the middle of the recruiting season, not ideal. They put it together pretty good. And you would assume this is a coaching staff that has got its chops on the recruiting side. So you're thinking that they're going to rebuild this recruiting class, but we're still going to have to wait another couple weeks to see what the future is of that. But what are your first takeaways on just the new staff? And who do you like on the staff? And what do you like about the direction they're going?
Yeah, I've been putting in a lot of research on some of these guys. You know, a lot of them aren't these huge names that a lot of college football fans, especially Oregon fans, were kind of looking for, maybe. But I like all the experience. I like the youth. I like the focus on recruiting. I think that's a big, you know, kind of a something that you wanted to see based on what Mario Cristobal and his staff were able to do at Oregon. You wanted to see that momentum continued. And I think that pretty much everybody that's come into Eugene in the past, you know, month or so has that experience. I mean, you look at a guy like Tosh Lapoy. I mean, man, that defensive coordinator job was going to be a tough one, especially with Dan Lanning already a defensive-minded guy. But Tosh, I mean, they've been talking about him as, you know, someone who's a target for a long time. And so, you know, his experience at Alabama, his experience in the NFL, you know, being a coordinator, being this recruiting guy, being this guy who's worked with guys like Myles Garrett and, you know, Grady Jarrett with the Falcons, and having this experience, I mean, that's just awesome stuff. And then at the college level, I mean, that 2015 Alabama team was stacked. He did a great job as a defensive coordinator, as a defensive line coach, even going back to his Pac-12 days, you know, at Cal and UW, getting to produce guys like Haole Kikaha and Cameron Jordan at Cal. So, you know, just I love that hire. That's probably my favorite one outside of Dan Lanning. But you got to love a lot of what they've done with, you know, Demetrius Martin at the cornerbacks coach. That's one that I really like. And he was able to bring in Christian Gonzalez from the portal. So I love it. I'm loving what I'm seeing so far.
Yeah, I would agree. I think the Tosh Lapoy hire is a big one. And, you know, if you've been around and you know those offensive coordinator, defensive coordinator positions, you know, that are floating around out there, you know, I don't know how many people saw him being the defensive coordinator for Oregon, especially if you go back in time where he was at Cal, where he was at UW. He said something interesting over the last week to a recruit. He's talking about how he did not like Oregon, obviously. From his perspective, he was anti-Oregon, recruited actively against Oregon, and now he's in a position where he's in the green and yellow, and he's actively trying to promote the brand and trying to get kids there. So it is wild to see how the tide has turned for these West Coast guys. And you talk about Demetrius Martin. I really like the West Coast connections that some of these guys have on the staff. When it first got announced, the first three guys got announced were mainly from the South, it felt like, and didn't really have as much connection out here. And I do think that recruiting, you have to lock down California and get as many of the recruits you can on the West Coast at least interested in your program. You know, I think what Mario Cristobal did that was fantastic was he basically looked at every one of the Western states and looked at the best athletes in these Western states and tried to get the best athlete from each state. And I think that was one of the biggest things that he did in his recruiting. Obviously, people focus on the South and getting kids from the South to come out here. But more important than that, I think he took some of the best players from each state west of the Mississippi and put them on this lineup. So I would love to see these guys continue to adapt and mold their recruiting to maintain the West Coast. I think people sometimes get maybe a little too enamored with the idea that the South's the only place to play football. You get a lot of great players from Texas, a lot of great players from California, and a plethora of other places in the West, obviously. So yeah, I was really excited to see that. Now, what, you have any question marks about the staff? Any parts of the staff that you might not like as much, or think that you may have some work to do there?
I do think that when I first saw the hire of Carlos Lachlan at running backs coach, I thought that was a really, really interesting one, just because he came from Western Kentucky as their running backs coach. And that was an air raid offense. I mean, Bailey Zappi put up historic passing numbers for that offense. And, you know, rushing wise, they weren't really, I wouldn't say effective, but they just didn't run the ball that much. And so I thought that was kind of an interesting pool to kind of, you know, dive into for that hire. But, you know, he's a phenomenal recruiter. So I think that's definitely one thing. And he's worked with some really good running backs in his time. Drew Merringer at tight ends coach was another one I kind of had a question mark about at first. You know, he was an offensive coordinator at Rutgers, the youngest Power Five signal caller or play caller, at the time. And he didn't really find a lot of success as an offensive coordinator, but what he's been able to do on the recruiting trail as well. I believe he was the Rivals Recruiter of the Year one year. I think that was a couple of years ago. So, you know, there's, if they're not successful necessarily on the field, you know, whether they put up a, you know, kind of a poor performance with their overall unit, it's, there's something else that they bring to the table. It's recruiting, or if they're not really known for recruiting, they do have that success, you know, on the field working with developing guys. So, you know, there's a little bit of everything with this staff. I think there are things to like with Lachlan and Merringer that they bring to the table. Some people I know were talking about, you know, Merringer with Rutgers didn't really have as much talent, you know, the Big Ten kind of stacked up against them, the youngest Power Five play caller. Like, it's hard to succeed in that situation, but you know, when he's been a position coach all over the country, I've really liked what I've seen. So those were the only question marks I think I had. There's no, you know, hire I'd say that I disliked right out of the gate. I think there's a lot to kind of take in with some of these younger guys with recruiting. You know, they don't have as much experience as you know, a lot of guys on the Oregon staff that is headed out now.
Yeah, I would agree there, especially even Lachlan, just the amount of coaching, the years that he's had in the position, pretty limited. But interesting guy, interesting background, see how that works. Going forward, though, I think the biggest news of the whole thing is the Bo Nix transfer. So let's talk about that a little bit, because I think everybody's got an opinion there. I think maybe opinions are going to shift a little bit and change a little bit, but we do know that the Ty Thompson camp was very vocal this last year, and people are thinking he's going to be the next future great Duck quarterback. But again, none of that's guaranteed. And so you have this transfer that maybe caught some people by surprise. I think maybe that was added to people's maybe original kind of discomfort with it. But I think it's also a heck of a move to be able to pull a guy who's already been a proven quarterback in the SEC, played a lot of games down there, and have a connection with the offensive coordinator that he had the most success with as a freshman. So I kind of can see it from both sides, and I kind of intended to be maybe a little bit more negative to begin with, 60-40, and I maybe now feel like I'm more 60-40 on the Bo Nix side. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, so when I first got the notification that he committed to Oregon, I was right there with you. I was more on the negative side. My question was why? Like, why would Oregon go after him more so than him coming to Oregon? I kind of get it from his perspective, but from Oregon's perspective, I didn't really understand it at first, because you know, you're kind of going through the same thing with Anthony Brown, where it was this rental, you know, this 1-2 year rental. And with Bo Nix, he's got 2 years of eligibility, maybe one if he decides to declare for the draft if he has a good year. But I like that connection with Kenny Dillingham as well, like you were talking about. So I think with the talent that Bo Nix has, I don't think he's reached his ceiling. That's why I'm a little bit more in favor of the addition with him than I was with Anthony Brown, because I feel like Anthony Brown kind of, you knew what he was going to be. I feel like Bo Nix hasn't necessarily reached that. You know, there was a lot of moving parts with the offensive line. He's had a couple different offensive coordinators in a few years, you know, the head coaching change. So I kind of cut him some slack with Auburn and everything going around there. This past season, he was injured too. So I like his fit a little bit more than I did at first, but at the same time, I was kind of overwhelmed with, you know, where we are in college football now with the transfer portal, because you know, you get a guy that comes in and everybody assumes he's going to be the starter. And then you look at guys like Butterfield and Thompson and Ashford, you know, my mind immediately went to, you know, they're hitting the portal. One of them is at least, and Ashford did, but you know, of course he went back home. So that obviously makes sense. But man, I was kind of concerned that it was going to turn off some of those guys that, you know, came in a couple of years ago. But it seems like Ty Thompson's all in, which I really like. You know, he's been kind of dialed in on Twitter. He's saying, you know, I'm locked in, I'm ready to go, that whole thing. So, you know, and I know Dan Lanning said during one of his press conferences that it is going to be an open quarterback competition. You know, it's not just going to be given to Bo Nix, even though on paper, I'm sure, you know, all the papers, all the magazines, they're all going to say Bo Nix is that QB1. But, you know, you can't count on a guy like Ty Thompson, who's been with the program for a year now, and Butterfield, who's been with the program. So I'm really looking forward to that quarterback room. I think Bo Nix, if I had to write down a starter right now in Sharpie, I'd probably go towards Bo Nix, just because of that connection with Dillingham. But Ty Thompson and Butterfield, they're as talented, you know, just as talented in my opinion, and the ceiling is just as high, if not higher.
I like what you said there about the ceiling being higher for Bo Nix than maybe what you saw for Anthony Brown. And I do think maybe part of the other discomfort with Bo Nix is coming directly from the relationship the fans have with Anthony Brown, right? So, and maybe even the history of the grad transfer quarterback, or now just the transfer portal quarterback. And I do agree that, you know, I think that Anthony Brown, you knew exactly what you were getting on a good day. Solid quarterback, man. I mean, solid quarterback. On a bad day, pretty average or below average, right? And it happened fairly quickly. With Bo Nix, you're thinking, hey, well, maybe he could come out and at least consistency-wise, maybe improve that position with a new coach that he can depend on and that the coach can depend on him. I agree that with the Ty Thompson group, you know, you got to believe that the kid can compete and he can win the job. But you also feel, if you're part of the real Ty Thompson group, that you might not get that fair of a shot at it. And we definitely know that last year, it was AB's job the whole year. We knew it. He's not going to take the job away. Halfway through the year, you knew the coaching staff was trying to protect all the red shirts. They weren't playing anybody. That AB was going to finish these games. The writing was on the wall there. Whereas this year, it felt like if you'd had that same coaching staff from last year, you would have had a really nice three-person battle. And maybe you have somebody transfer at the end of that battle if they don't get that gig. But to see the way it broke down, where yes, you probably lost one of those quarterbacks and you still might lose another one, depending on how things break down. But I did think it was interesting at the end of the day, it felt like you traded Bo Nix for Robbie Ashford. And I don't know if you necessarily won that trade. I think Robbie Ashford has a lot of potential as well. And, you know, I would love to see him do well in Auburn. Obviously you would love to see him do well in an Oregon uniform, but I have no ill will against the kids and against these athletes. They're trying to do what's best for them and their families. There's no problem for there. But I do think it's going to be interesting going forward how this quarterback thing is going to be handled, because you're right, he does have 2 years of eligibility, but it looks like he's only going to be here for the one. Now you're in a rental situation. Does this upset the apple cart to where you lose both transfers and you're dealt with Bo Nix and a bunch of walk-ons? That would be horrible. Or you just have transfer portal land in the quarterback room and everybody's just there for whatever they can do. But, I mean, this year's wild. I mean, look at Utah. Utah started the year with what they thought was their guy because he was the grad transfer. He was the transfer quarterback. He's not. Three games in, he's gone. Cam Rising goes in, and you win the conference. So what's to say it might not happen this way, where Bo Nix comes in, starts the Georgia game, maybe you lose against the BYU game, and all of a sudden Ty Thompson's your starter for the Pac-12.
Yeah, I mean, if you go towards a starting quarterback every year that has the most experience, with Oregon's situation now, you're just going to be swapping transfer quarterbacks every year. You're not going to be developing, you know, those guys that you brought in and you recruited, not necessarily this staff, but, you know, the program recruited. So, you know, I've always been in favor of developing the guys that you have, and especially with these quarterbacks. I mean, I don't know if there's been a more talented quarterback to come out of high school and into Eugene than Ty Thompson. And Butterfield, I think, is just as good. I don't feel like a lot of people, I feel like people sleep on him because of what Ashford was coming out of high school and what Thompson was as well, and they go off of the stars. And I think Butterfield's right there too. But if you could just keep trying to get this guy that's got this experience and has won games, you're just not going to develop the guys that you probably promised that were going to be the future of the program. So originally, that's why I was against the Bo Nix addition. But I think that Ty Thompson's talent, I do think that at some point this year, I feel like he's going to take over. I did feel that last year as well. I felt like there was going to be a point, maybe mid-season, where they were going to turn towards Ty Thompson. I felt like there were a lot of cases toward the end of the year where they probably could have gone towards Ty Thompson as well. But I do think that Bo Nix has more experience that I like than Anthony Brown did. Boston College, I think, they had those games against Clemson, but you didn't really get those big wins, those huge performances that you've seen from Bo Nix, with Kenny Dillingham as OC. He won the Rookie of the Year. Put up 48 against Alabama that year, more than anybody had ever put up against a Nick Saban defense. So I like that a little bit more. I think Bo Nix, I like him and trust him a little bit more with the offense than Anthony Brown. If I put him in Anthony Brown's shoes last year, and I think with the position, the skill position players that they're going to have coming into next year, I like Bo Nix a little bit more. I have more confidence than I would with Anthony Brown, but at the same time, you just want to develop the guys that you have too. So I want to see Ty Thompson kind of take over. I want to see Butterfield get some more playing time. But the thing is some people are scared with starting a guy like Ty Thompson or Butterfield against Georgia starting next year. I feel like if they, played against an FCS school or maybe like a, like a Nevada or a San Jose State like other years, I feel like they'd have more confidence. But it's the reigning national champions. It's the Chick-fil-A kickoff. It's never started a game. I feel like that had something to do with the addition of Bo Nix and trying to get that, trying to get that experience, that SEC experience.
Well, and I think the coaching staff feels the pressure to win now, day one, and they're going to take the best quarterback they can, and they're going to take a quarterback they can trust. I like to push back a little bit against the start the freshman group because in real life, the only time that Oregon has started their freshman is when their sky is falling and their season's terrible. It was Chris Miller in the 80s, and it was Justin Herbert in his freshman year, when it was the worst season we've seen in modern time for Oregon football. So I tend to think if you start the freshman, your season's going pretty bad. I don't think you want to start the freshman. And so to me, it's an easy one to say, well, you're obviously going to look at Bo Nix as being the guy who has the experience. He's the guy going into that first game you feel like you can trust, kind of like you did last year with Anthony Brown and going into Ohio State. You knew that was going to be the biggest game of the year. And to put it in the hands of a senior who's been there, is not going to get rattled. It's exactly what happened. He went there, he didn't get rattled. The moment wasn't too big for him, and looked great doing it, and brought home probably one of the biggest non-conference wins you've ever seen in the history of the program. So this next year, are you asking Bo Nix to basically do the same thing? Now, again, I think if Ty Thompson's the guy, then he's going to be the starter, or he's going to be so close that they might be looking at trying to play him as well. And there's no red shirt to maintain, so maybe there's packages for both quarterbacks. But I do think that the start Ty Thompson group is going to be very vocal during this offseason and putting a lot of pressure on the program to go in the direction of the young guy.
Yeah, and I think, Mariota was another one that a lot of people, he kind of came in, not a lot of people knew about him. He redshirted 2011 and then came in as a redshirt freshman, had never started. And it wasn't like this, the Oregon program was falling off. Like they had just won the Rose Bowl and then they come in and start this new guy and, history wrote itself. But yeah, I think there's a lot of risk involved, but I think that's what this coaching staff has done so far, with hiring a 35-year-old head coach and with hiring a lot of guys who, like we talked about, had some question marks, and then bringing in a guy like Bo Nix out of the transfer portal when you already have a couple really talented quarterbacks that probably could get the job done. I feel like they do a good job. It's just, you want that experience at the same time to, kind of fall back on, especially against the SEC, because, Bo Nix having that SEC experience, that huge game experience. Obviously it hasn't played to the level of like an SEC title game or a playoff as much, but SEC is as big a stage as you can get during the regular season. So, with a guy like that, I think you can put your trust in him. But at the same time, I just feel like if Bo Nix, they do the same thing with Bo Nix where like Anthony Brown last year where he starts every game, I feel like Ty Thompson is going to kind of lose faith in the coaching staff, just trying to get developed there, because it's just the name of the game in college football now. If you don't get a couple years where you don't get any, starts, any playing time that you feel you deserve, you want to look elsewhere. And I don't feel like Ty Thompson is as much that guy, but it is the name of the college football game right now. The transfer portal is the hot trend. And it's important to some of these quarterbacks when you look at guys like Joe Burrow and Baker Mayfield and Jalen Hurts who have transferred and had that success, after not playing as much, at the end of their previous tenures. So, it's possible that Ty Thompson doesn't get much playing time, that they stick with Bo Nix. I do like the idea of kind of doing this, not necessarily like they did with Derek Carr and Mariota with the Raiders, where they kind of just put, Mariota in as like this third and short kind of run the ball guy, but maybe they use them both, off and on. Maybe they use Ty Thompson, as kind of a decoy of sorts. I think they have the talent for that, but I think Bo Nix is probably going to be the starter, like you said, probably from the spring, if not the the fall camp. But I really want to see Ty Thompson, develop, because I think that he could be, the next guy for the Ducks. But having a guy with experience at the same time, it's kind of a safe bet. But I do like the freshmen that they have as well.
Well, and I think guys were talking about a great point you said about Mariota because again, people were talking about him. You know, the same thing goes with like LaMichael James. Like he was the scout team player of the week every week, right? So it's like you have these guys who you know what's coming. I mean, Darren Thomas left basically it felt like because Mariota was right behind him pushing him out the door. It does not necessarily feel like that's the case right now. So I think there's a lot of people whose hope is that Ty Thompson's going to be the next great Oregon quarterback. But that doesn't necessarily mean it's going to happen. And if last year was any kind of case study, you know, people were saying, are these guys not as good as Anthony Brown? When Anthony Brown was at his worst, there were a lot of people who were saying, there's got to be somebody better in the room than him that can play. So then the theory is, well, are they not developing those guys? Are those guys not as good? Is the quarterback recruiting not as good as they thought it was going to be? Because there was a situation there where you needed a transfer quarterback to come out here and play some mediocre football at times. And you couldn't find anybody better. At that point, it felt like. Now, granted, I feel like these coaching staff had a bigger picture in mind, knowing that he was going to get the job. It felt like it was in the bag to begin with. It felt like it was not a fair competition. And the difference of age is a huge part of this, right? Because again, you start talking about having a super senior versus all these freshmen and sophomores. So, or COVID freshmen, whatever you want to call them. So I do think it's an interesting one. Going forward, though, I think a quarterback's best friend is the running game, and you don't know what you're going to have in this running game. You're still waiting on CJ. You have Travis in the transfer portal. There's still hopes of maybe Travis reconsiders and comes back, or CJ comes back, or whatever else. But as of right now, Trey Benson just got declared that he's going to be at FSU next year. You got Sean Dollars coming back. You got Byron Carwell coming back. But I think right now, the running back room might be the most untested group of the whole offense.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. You can't really bank on bringing back Travis Dye from the portal. You can't really bank on CJ Verdell at this point. I mean, CJ Verdell, in my mind, has already proven what he needs to
I
prove
agree.
for NFL scouts. I mean, he's got years of of
Yeah, he
film.
was starting as a freshman.
Absolutely, yeah, he's been the guy. So, and obviously, the last couple of years with injuries, maybe that's why he wants another one last full year. I feel like that would be really the only thing he has to prove is that durability, because he was talking about it before this past season where he's like, I want to put up 2,000 yards, I want to be healthy for the whole season. And of course that didn't happen, had a really bad ACL injury. So I feel like that would be the only reason why he comes back, but I don't think he has to prove anything. I still think he's an NFL draft pick, and I think Travis Dye is as well. But I do like what I saw from Byron Cardwell in a rather limited sense. You didn't really see him get a load of carries for a whole half. Maybe it was a drive or two, you kind of see him take over, but he's a big play guy. I mean, he averaged, I think, close to like 8.5 yards a carry, had 61 carries. I mean, he was electric. And I really think that he could be a guy that takes over that RB1 spot if Guy and Verdell both leave. But the thing is dollars, he only really got that run a little bit in 2020, Pac-12 championship game. Don't really know what he's going to look like coming back from that injury, because they talked about, maybe he comes back mid-November, maybe we have him for the postseason, and he just, you never heard from, what that injury necessarily was. So I'm hopeful that he can return healthy in the spring and he kind of shows what he could be, because of the Pac-12 championship, you really saw his potential. But that's why I think in 2023, I think that recruiting that running back room, that pool of talent in 2023, I think that's huge, because 2022, you didn't get any. In 23, there's so much talent that's still out there. You look at guys like Jaden Lemar, who's taken an offer there. And taking a visit. So there's so many guys, Cedric Ervin, I believe he's not fully committed with Notre Dame. They were talking to him in the summer last year. So, I feel like that's kind of a fallback point. You have so much talent to maybe, if 2022 and Cardwell and Sean Dollars aren't really the guy, I feel like that 23, you have some guys that you can look at as well. And then of course the transfer portal is a great pool for talent as well.
Right. And again, I think that's a good place to look, because, transfer portal is such that, it feels like the position players of wide receiver, running back can kind of almost plug and play. I mean, right, they're depend on the scheme or whatnot. It feels like you could be a pretty good running back at any system in the country and transfer to maybe a team that's on the rise, or a team that needs just a couple more bodies in that room. When we knew going into last season that it was going to get lean, and now it looks just completely decimated. That room is very, very, very limited. So I think they're going to need to get bodies either way. And I would assume that the wide receiver room is in the same boat. I mean, obviously you had a flurry of wide receiver exploits in that last game. We finally got to see wide receivers catch the ball and run and be in an open space, which was awesome. But having those freshmen played as much as they played this last year, I think is going to be a huge deal for them in Franklin and Hudson. But be able to have the other guys like Thornton and Brevard and everybody else coming in to the fold. I don't know exactly where Seven's going to be, but you would assume that there's going to need to be some more bodies in that wide receiver room. Everybody talks about how deep the wide receiver room was at the beginning of the year, and it was. By the end of the year, you had two deep. You had walk-ons in the two deep. So, I mean, it was a wild situation at the end of the year, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And, of course, the talent that they have up front that you got to see in the Alamo Bowl is awesome. I think that's going to be really exciting to watch next year, but there's not a lot of depth. And I think that having some experience there is really important. And I know that the Oregon coaching staff and Dan Lanning, they were looking at some receivers in the transfer portal, because I believe they offered Jacob Cowing. He ended up going to Arizona. And then I can probably guarantee that Brendan Rice was the guy that they were looking at. They looked at him in high school. He ended up going to USC. So I do think that I feel like a transfer portal receiver is coming. I thought maybe it would have been Brendan Rice, just because of how much they were involved a couple years ago. Completely new staff, but of course the program, the school, I'm sure that was still intriguing for him. But yeah, I think trying to pick up a receiver in the transfer portal is probably a top priority, especially on the offense. But you have some guys to build around as well. So, I really like the idea of putting Seven McGee as kind of a slot, kind of that Jalen Redd a little bit role. We can kind of still put him in the backfield, kind of run some, really tricky stuff with him. I think he's explosive. I think he's fast. Kind of one of those throwback guys. I say throwback as in like 10 years ago, guys like DeAnthony Thomas and Kenyon Barner, you could really play around with them. So, and I like the talent that they have. I like the size that they have with Franklin and Thornton. You have some smaller guys, you have some bigger guys. It's hard to replace a guy like Devin Williams, who just towers over everybody. And he was this, security blanket for Anthony Brown, especially late in the year. So I kind of hope that they find a big target like that they can find. But at the same time, I think a lot of confidence for me goes into the tight end room with all those guys coming back with Matavau and Ferguson and Spencer Webb. I think those guys are going to be much more utilized. At least I hope they are. I feel like at Florida State with Dillingham, I don't think they use them as much, the tight ends as much. So that's one thing I'm really looking forward to on offense is utilizing those tight ends, not just in blocking, because I know that was a big part of what they did. Yeah, for Mario Cristobal, he was, you got to block if you're a tight end. But I want to see them catch the ball too. It feels like it's been a while since we had a tight end that was running loose in the middle of the field. Jacob Braylon was really the last guy I think that was such a core part of the passing game. I kind of want to see that.
Oh, absolutely. And you got Patrick Herbert as well coming off an injury in that room. So,
Absolutely.
yeah, I do think that they should, especially late in the year last year when he started to have the wide receivers go down. I thought Spencer Webb should have been utilized much more like a wide receiver. He's got, I've had him on and he gave me some great insight in the Rose Bowl, him and Hunter Kampmeyer and how they would kind of run them two together and use him as the decoy because everybody thought he was going to be the guy catching the pass, instead throw it to Hunter. The way that they utilized the tight ends last year, I feel like they could have done a lot more with it. And I hope that this group sees the film from last year and sees where they can kind of improve the offense, because it feels like having two tight ends in the same recruiting class that both got playing time as true freshmen is remarkable. And it feels like both of them have a real skill set that are different. And that's just an incredible tool to have in your toolbox, be able to wheel out double tight, and both of them can go catch balls in the flat. They can both block. They can both carry the rock in a fly sweep or something.
Yeah, I'm really excited by the athleticism that they have at tight end. You saw it from Spencer Webb a couple of years ago. He's as athletic a tight end as I can remember at Oregon. And Ferguson's got it too. Matavau's got it, and they've got the blocking down. But yeah, I definitely want to see some design plays for them. Get them some routes down the field. I guess just down the field offense is something I'm definitely looking forward to next year. But with those bodies, man, those guys are huge. Those guys are monsters. So I'm definitely looking forward to, an uptick in their reps in the passing game, not just in blocking. But yeah, having them, the fly sweep kind of thing, I think that's interesting. Those guys are fast for their size. I'm really looking forward to, the potential of those guys, all of them. And Herbert, yeah, definitely. I'm very excited for Patrick Herbert to finally be healthy and get some run as well, because I was really looking forward to his development. They were hyping him up all spring last year.
Absolutely. Sorry about that. My phone here. I had a call from my son's school. I can't believe why they would call me now, because my son is in distance learning for the week thanks to COVID. Yeah. So what? Let's chat about the defense a little bit. I think that's the side everybody's excited about. I think Dan Lanning coming in, changing kind of a philosophy, being the more of a defensive-minded coach. Obviously, you talked about Tosh Lupoi having a bunch of other guys on that, bunch of people who have eyes on the defensive, Matt Pallage, everybody else there. I think there's going to be a real focus to get the best athletes on the team to really be playing at their best. And again, in the last recruiting classes, four or five recruiting classes, it feels like the best athletes have been on the defensive side. And now you've got this linebacker room that's completely stacked. I do think next year is going to have a huge focus on Noah Sewell. And you're gonna have the, Justin Flo, hopefully, if he can stay healthy, be the next big Oregon defensive player, right? So I do think that this year is gonna be fantastic on the defense. Who are your people you're looking for on the defensive side outside of those guys, obviously, that we know about?
I think the defensive line is going to be huge because you're losing a generational talent like Kayvon Thibodeaux. So you want to find guys off the edge that can still produce. Obviously, Kayvon is as irreplaceable a guy as is going to come out of Oregon into the NFL. But I'm looking at a guy like Braden Swinson. I really liked what I saw from him when Kayvon was injured, and that half where he had the targeting call. I really like what I saw. He's very consistent, very fast. You can kind of move him at that linebacker spot. Put on a lot of weight, a lot of good weight going into this year. Looked really fast, explosive. And I like that Popo Amavai is coming back up front. I love what I saw. He was probably, in my mind, one of the most improved players on the defense. And especially replacing guys like Jordan Scott and Austin Faulkner, you really wanted to find that production, that consistent production. And I think that, Keon Weir-Hudson showed some flashes, but I really want to see more consistency from him as well. Because I think not just Kayvon, but you saw some times where Brandon Dorlus and Weir-Hudson and Popo, you kind of saw this potential of dominance at times. Like that Cal game, they were just running rampant over that offensive line. And, at times during the Stanford game as well, you saw it. So I think this unit has potential to be dominant. We know the linebackers have, crazy potential with Sewell and Justin Flo if he's healthy, Keith Brown. And then another guy I'm really interested to see how they use him is Jeffrey Bossa. In my mind, he was the best, probably the best freshman on the team, offense or defense. He stepped in. He wasn't really expected to get a lot of playing time. He came in as a safety, moved him to linebacker, and he was fantastic. Obviously, there's some bumps and scratches. He's never really played linebacker at that level, but he played a very good linebacker for a guy who came in as a safety. You probably wouldn't know that they converted him, right before the Ohio State game. And so I want to see, I know they talked about moving him back to safety, but at the same time, I feel like if you need a guy at linebacker again, he's definitely a plug and play guy. But safety, I feel like, is probably where he's at his best. And then the cornerback spot is going to be, it was decimated. I mean, Mykael Wright's gone. DJ James is gone. You have so much youth back there. But you bring in a guy like Christian Gonzalez, who I was absolutely all in on when he, transferred from Colorado. I loved watching his film. I think he's a potential lockdown guy. I think he's going to be a starter day one, but at the same time, there's a lot of talent back there. Darren Barkins was a guy I felt like was absolutely slept on, and I'm sad he didn't really get a lot of playing time until the end of the year. Avante Dickerson, I really like his potential. Jalen Davies got some run a little bit early in the year as well. So I think there's potential at cornerback, but at the same time, I like that they brought in Christian Gonzalez, who's, an all Pac-12 potential guy in my mind. And then the defensive line, I forgot to mention as well, Taki Taimani. Brought him in from UW. That guy's a mammoth up front. So I feel like he's a potential starter, definitely on the two deep. There's a lot of potential, but of course you lose a couple stars like McKinley and Kayvon that are going to be hard to replace. But I still think it's a very solid unit, and I love the guys that are going to be coaching them.
Yeah, and I really think guys coming back with something to prove, like Bennett Williams. Bennett had such a good year before he got hurt. Guys that can fill a variety of different roles. When there were so many guys that went down on the linebacker core, you really miss guys like Jackson Leduc, guys that came in with that. Noah Sewell, Justin Flo, all those guys came in. That whole linebacker core came in all together, and Noah's really the only guy that's been able to play because of injury. So. Just there's a variety of different guys. I really like those names. I thought Jeff Bossa was one of the biggest names on the whole list. And one of the guys I think is an interesting one and what he's going to do next year is DJ Johnson. This is a guy, the Predator. This is a guy who is all over the place. I don't know how many D1 top tier, top 25 football teams even have anyone that goes two ways. On their roster, who even can fill two different spots. It felt like during the COVID year, DJ Johnson probably was the offensive MVP. He was a huge weapon for Tyler Shuck, had numerous catches that he could stretch out into first downs and 10, 20-yard gains, numerous touchdowns as well. Relegated this last year to somewhat of maybe of a heavy package tight end guy, and then onto the defensive side because they were so decimated on defense, he needed to play more over there. So it'd be interesting to see how they use him next year because, like we said, there's going to be a plethora of guys in the tight end room still looking pretty good, and that room looked fairly decent, but maybe DJ Johnson is a guy who's the next edge rusher. Again, a guy who was incredibly touted out of high school, went to Miami to be an edge rusher, came to Oregon, played very well wearing number 7 his first year on the edge, and really set the other side from Kayvon. So it's going to be interesting. I thought Braden Swinson played great this year. Obviously, I have a lot of love for Mace Funa. He's been on numerous times here. Just an absolutely quality individual and just a really solid football player. So there's guys on the edge who I feel like are going to be ready to take that next level, but I was so impressed with Brandon Dorlus this year. I thought I knew what you were going to get in Popo. I've always been high on Popo, and I thought this year is going to be a great year with the other guys just kind of leaving and giving him more reps. And that would just be a natural fit for him. But Dorlus, I was really impressed with his disruption on the line, one in the run game, but two, he got after the quarterback, man. And that was something that Jordan Scott really, for all the love that we have for Fat Mac, he was really unable to put much pressure on the quarterback. And Dorlus just broke through the line numerous times to put pressure on the QB. I thought Dorlus could have been the defensive MVP last year.
Yeah, I think he showed a lot of potential at the end of 2020. I believe I wrote, I think it was in April or May, I had my my breakout players to watch for the upcoming season. Dorlus was definitely up there. And what I like most about Dorlus is his ability to play both on the edge and in the middle. I mean, he's got the size to play both. He's got the speed to play off the edge. And I love his ability, like you said, to get after the quarterback. You look at his stats and the box scores, like he doesn't, it doesn't pop off the page, but there's so many pressures. There's so many, times where he gets the quarterback out of the pocket. He blows up plays, and they have to kind of switch gears. So, excuse me. So, Dorlus, I definitely think is going to be one of my favorite guys to watch next year.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, anytime you can get a double team, that's why I used to tell Jordan and I used to have numerous conversations where I said, dude, you're Troy Dye's favorite guy on the whole team, because Troy Dye is putting together an all-time great linebacker stat line. His stats are ridiculous. When you compare him to all the other linebackers at Oregon, he has a just massive amount of plays that he is an impact guy on. You can thank Jordan a lot for that. Jordan cleared the middle. Jordan was a constant double team, space eater, good in the run package. But yeah, you're right. Never could really get to the quarterback, and there's a reason why. He had two guys hanging on him from different edges. I do like the defense going in next year. I think you made some really good points about the youth on the backside. It would be interesting to see if there's any more transfers that come in that maybe can impact, or who are some of the guys on this team, this class, this year, who might impact this team in the fall. And there's some guys on this team this year who might crack that code. Guys who are really, really talented. We don't maybe know exactly where they're going to go, but like a Jaleel Tucker, I mean, his tape is ridiculous. And so again, just kind of some of those guys. I don't spend a lot of time on recruiting, but it is interesting right now. January, February is when I really kind of dive into it, and you really start thinking, okay, well, what would happen if this guy could play here with this guy over there and that guy over here? And you really kind of start to scheme and brainstorm, which is possibly one of the downfalls to it, because then you get in the fall and you're like, hey, I had already planned out this kid should have been starting. Where's this kid's action? So again, I think you're going to have guys like Steve Stevens get back to his playing time. You're going to get guys like Bennett get back to his position, Jamal Hill get back to his position. So there's not going to be a lot of spots open, but the way that they rotate on defense, you would assume maybe some of these guys could get in. And there are two guys that are very intriguing on this recruiting this year, this class, and that is Ben Roberts and Sir Mills, the two defensive linemen, both very big bodies. And it would be really interesting to see how they translate, because most of the time they don't translate on the offensive side. It takes guys a couple years to be able to get in and break the lineup on an offensive line, especially this year's offensive line, because you've returned basically everybody. But on the defensive side, we've seen guys come in as freshmen, Jordan Scott, Brandon Dorlus, two guys right back to back, that produce as freshmen right away. So it'd be really interesting to see if any of these guys can do that. The size these guys are coming in as freshmen are ridiculous. So it might be something that they might look at in the future.
Jalen Jelks is another guy I thought of that contributed very early, I think.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, and Ty Monty might be another guy to watch as well. And I thought his addition was definitely interesting because Mels and Roberts were coming in. You have a lot of guys returning up front, and then they come in and bring in an established starter on a really good defensive line. And that kind of, I'm not really surprised because I remember Dan Lanning was saying that, Taki grew up an Oregon fan. So I'm not necessarily surprised, but I thought that, that defensive line is, as you lose Kayvon Thibodeaux, but you still have a lot of experience, which is kind of the opposite of what we came into last year. And so, yeah, I think Dorlas is going to be kind of the guy that they double a little bit. And I want to see, you know, them kind of move guys like Sir Mels. I want to see what he can do. Ben Roberts, I really want to see. And what I really like is that Roberts and Mels are both former UW commits as well. You know, for an Oregon fan, that's definitely a fun thing to think about, that so many defensive linemen, particularly where UW kind of excels, they develop all these guys up front. They all came to Oregon instead.
Well, you gotta like that for the rivalry just alone. I mean, I do like the idea that you have built in a natural rival with Oregon State, right? It's your obvious rival. It's in-house, it's in-state. But to have that extra kind of bigger regional rival with us and Washington is so unique. And I do really kind of revel in it a little bit, especially when the Ducks are doing well. And so that whole weekend where the Ducks went up, and of course I was there with my family living in Portland, we go to those games regularly. The fact that that all went down when the Ducks went up there and won that game, the Huskies thought they were going to win it after it got canceled the year before because of COVID, and they were so mad because the Ducks went to the Pac-12 championship game and that was a robbery and everything else. Then they go and they lose that game. The coach has the interaction on the sideline. The coach is suspended halfway through that game or at the end of that game, whatever the case may be, then gets fired. The recruits leave. They go here for, I mean, two of those guys go right. I mean, it was like a tsunami hit that program. And I have friends of mine in there. I've got family members, friends of mine connected to that program. And they were all lamenting how they thought that Jimmy Lake was a disaster and it was going to go down. They actually were telling me the beginning of the year that they thought they were going to beat the Ducks. They were going to have a good year. They're going to win 10 games. Then they lost to Montana, and they said, "We're going to lose every game. This coach is terrible. You guys are going to beat us by 50." So it went very quickly for them. But that level of panic. But talk about this. Let's talk about the schedule next year. Because speaking of the Huskies, Huskies come to town, and it's a late game for the Huskies this year, which is going to be awesome. Let's talk about the schedule a little bit. Obviously, we know the first game in Georgia. Eastern Washington is your somewhat of your gimme, even though Eastern Washington's a pretty good program. Then you got BYU at home. I tend to think the BYU game at home is going to be a huge one, coming off of BYU going undefeated against the Pac-12 last year. Kalani Sitake and the interview with this coaching staff and whatnot, the idea. There's just multiple storylines there, but we got to start with Georgia. What are your thoughts there with the Georgia game? Does Oregon, you think Oregon have a chance in this game? You think that Georgia's going to have to reload, and we know the history of teams that come off a national championship have a tough time that first game, the next year might struggle. The pressure is kind of off of them because they won the national championship, but they're at home in Atlanta. All the family's going to be there. You think the Ducks can slide in here and maybe take one of these games? This is going to be a big one. The Ducks need to win one of these games against the SEC, and this could be their opportunity.
Yeah, I think this is as tough a non-conference game as you can get, because it's a neutral site game in Atlanta, Georgia, against the Georgia Bulldogs, which bothers the stew out of me, to take a word out of Philip Rivers' mouth. But I do think that they have a chance with the talent coming back. And I think the talent leaving Georgia is going to be interesting to see. Obviously, they're one of those programs that just reloads. I mean, they're just pumping out talent all the time. But and when you have guys like Jordan Davis and N'Kobe Dean and, you know, Lewis Cine, some of those guys on that defense that are heading out, I mean, it's really hard to replace a guy that's 360 pounds playing on that defensive line. And, you know, won all the awards you could win. N'Kobe Dean won the Buckus Award. So, you know, just an absolutely loaded defense last year. You lose your defensive coordinator. Probably going to have some guys transferring. You've already seen a couple guys entering the NFL. So it's going to look different. I'm sure that, you know, the defense is still going to be good. I don't think they're going to take that much of a drop off. But I do think that Oregon, all the cards are against them. New coaching staff, Dan Lanning's coming back to coach against his former team, you know, one of his mentors and Kirby Smart. against his former program in that state. So it's going to be hostile. Probably not a whole lot of Oregon fans. I'm sure you'll probably be in town for
Oh
that.
yeah, I'm going.
Definitely. Yeah, definitely gotta wear the green there. And there's not going to be a lot of it there, but yeah, definitely make some noise.
I think it'll be fun down there. I just hope it does not go the way of Chip's first game at Boise State, where you've got the brand new coach, brand new AD, brand new head of the Pac-12 conference, all sitting together. The Ducks didn't get a first down in the first half, and they're like, "What in the hell's going on here?" Of course, then the game ends with the LeGarrette punch, and that is brutal. And then that's on a Thursday night. That was the only game on that Thursday night. Then there's all the talk the next day. It was just an absolute terrible year. Had to try to rebuild it. They did rebuild it. They got back to the Rose Bowl that year. But it would be interesting to see. I mean, you can't get worse start than that. I mean, that was the worst start you could have possibly imagined. Losing to Boise State, second year in a row, all the chatter from them. This is a game that legitimately is a win-win in my mind. The Ducks go there. I think that if they win the game, it's frontline news. Everybody is going to be absolutely out of their mind. If they lose the game, it's all good. It's in Atlanta. It's the national champion. You can't get any better than that. You know, they fought it hard. They played well. Even, I mean, I guess a blowout would be a lose situation, but you go out there and you play a reasonable game. Even if you lose that game, I still think you come back with your head held high, saying, "Hey, let's go ahead and get this thing. See if you can run the table and get it, take care of business, and maybe even find yourself back in the CFP." I think it's going to be a lot, though, for the Pac-12 to get a CFP team in. I think a team's going to have to run the table.
Oh, absolutely. And I like that that game comes early, just because if you lose that first game, if you run the table and you look like Oregon team of old, where you're just routing everybody, then yeah, I definitely think they have a case with their only loss being against Georgia. Absolutely. And a win at home against BYU. Of course, you're at home, you've got that advantage. But BYU is going to have a lot of players coming back. I didn't think BYU was going to be anywhere close to what they were, during the COVID year, and they went out and won 11 games. Of course, they lost the bowl game to UAB, which was a stinker, but they're still going to have a really good coaching staff, really good team going in. So that's not, in my mind, that's not a gimme at all. But at the same time, what kind of scares me is a couple of those road games. There's a couple places where Oregon stumbled a little bit. Pullman, Tucson. I don't think you can sleep on this Arizona
No.
team. I know they won one game, but man, did they reload. And Jed Fish has got that, the momentum going as much as you can for a program that only won one game last year. Berkeley is going to be tough. UCLA at home, I think, is going to be tough. Colorado, I'm not really sure what you're going to see from Colorado, but it is Boulder, little
Yeah.
kind of a tough out. Corvallis, Oregon State's going to be probably pretty good again.
Brutal.
So I think it's going to be a tougher schedule than what we saw last year, that road schedule especially. If you beat Georgia, I feel like everything's in front of you. I feel like Oregon is, the number one team in the Pac-12 if they can take care of business.
Oh, dude, the end of the year is just absolutely brutal. I mean, Washington, Utah, Oregon State. Now, you get two of those games at home, but I think Washington's going to be improved. They can't be as bad as they were last year. It just the whole season imploded around them. Oregon State's going to continue to improve. Oregon State's going to continue notch by notch by notch by notch. You know, right? They got seven. Six games last year, they'll probably win seven next year. You know, they're going to be in the running. And last year they probably won some games they shouldn't have won, like the Utah game. Maybe the USC game earlier, whatever the case may be. But they also lost games they shouldn't have lost, right? So you know, if you play the way that they're supposed to be playing, I think they're going to be in the running for the North. Obviously, you know, Utah is going to be running for the whole Pac-12. I don't think they're going to have a huge drop off. And then you've got this Washington team that's just absolutely wild to me. So I think that last three games, and we've seen this in the past, right? Where you had a team like, the Cristobal's year where he went to the Rose Bowl, they lost to Arizona State last second game before the Beav game. I mean, there's been stories like this where, you know, you lose the first game, you're winning a whole bunch, and then you lose that one at the end of the year. It feels like it's a backbreaker. Well, the same thing could happen this year. Now, Utah, I think at home is going to be the game, right? Huge revenge, have all the stuff from last year. It's going to be obviously a different team, different animal this year, but It felt like Oregon completely fell apart against Utah. Not only did Utah play the better game, and Utah on that day was the better team, but it felt like Oregon just played terribly both times. And I was at the game in Vegas, literally, like, I couldn't get enough drinks from the bar. I was like, is this seriously what we're watching right now? So it's going to be interesting. I agree. Arizona is going to be a tough one. Jaden Delora down there. I think that you're right. I think that for a team that only won one game, it's a much better team than people are going to give it credit for. And down there is always tough. Boulder is going to be tough first weekend in November. You know, there's just a lot of problems with this schedule, and that's the whole goal. You run the table in the Pac-12, you should be in that college football playoff. I don't care at any year. There's enough good football out here. The representative of the Pac-12 should have a conversation, should be at that table.
Absolutely. And I think if they do run the table, or at least win, you know, the North, which I would probably put them ahead of anybody else in the North, I think that's kind of safe, even though there's so much new talent, coaching staff and all that. I still put them at the top in the North, but the South is so interesting because I expected UCLA to lose so much talent. They bring back Chip Kelly. They bring back DTR, Zach Charbonnet. You know, they lost a couple guys via the transfer portal, got a couple guys in the transfer portal. So I think they're still going to be pretty good. Utah, I don't know how you really think that they're going to fall off too much. USC could be the Pac-12 South champion. I mean, Lincoln Riley's in his first year. They need a lot of holes to fill. You know, they've got some guys via the transfer portal, but you need a quarterback. You need an offensive line, defensive line. A lot of that defense has holes. So, you know, of course, the coaching staff looks pretty, but you still have a lot of work to do. And of course, you know, I don't think you can sleep on Arizona. I don't think they're going to be like a 7-5, 8-4 team, but I think they're going to probably pull off some upsets, and they've got the history. I don't want to get into it too much because I'm sure your fans don't want to, you know, hear too much about a couple of those games a few years ago. But, you know, Tucson's not an easy place to play if you're an Oregon team, you know, fresh off of a couple of tough games in Pullman and Stanford. I mean, you don't know about Stanford either in the North. They could be completely new. You know, and maybe they shock some people as well.
I agree. I think the whole conference is wild card. I think there's so much coaching changes. I think that, you know, obviously Stanford had probably one of their worst years in David Shaw's time there last year. They have the number one recruiting class this year. I mean, it's like you can't make this stuff up. So I do think Cal's probably going to continue to maybe get notch by notch better. They might be plateaued, though. They might be just in that zone where they're the 6-7 win team. I think Arizona State's another real huge question mark. What happens with Herm? Felt like he was on the hot seat halfway through this year. They had high hopes. You're right. UCLA, man, I think they're getting better. The Oregon Ducks had a huge game against UCLA this year. That was a big game. And so if that comes to Autzen this next year, you know, that's not going to be an easy win. So what are your thoughts on just kind of overall win-loss record? What would you be comfortable with? Obviously, we think that the 12-win season is probably out of reach. Feels like they're going to have one loss maybe on here at least. But maybe up to three losses? What are your thoughts on how many losses you see on this schedule?
I feel like last year going in, and when I was looking at the schedule around this time, that Utah game, now I didn't know what Utah was going to look like. I figured Brewer was going to be the guy, and they were probably going to be one of those teams that kind of hangs around but maybe falls off toward the end. And they obviously surprised everybody, me included. But I just felt like that game in Salt Lake City was that game where I feel like where hopes die. And I feel like in this season, I feel like it's that Arizona game. I don't know why. I feel like the momentum for Oregon could be coming in. Yeah. You know, I just have a feeling they'll beat Georgia and then lose to Arizona. I just feel like it could be one of those years. You know, it's the Pac-12. You know, you have no idea what's going to happen. But it's a new staff, a lot of new pieces in the starting lineup. You know, it looks good on paper, but at the same time, it did last year. It did the year before. So I'm not necessarily screaming for a Pac-12 championship win. I'm not necessarily screaming for, you know, a Rose Bowl college football playoff. I'm keeping my expectations a little lower just because there's so much new in the Pac-12. Like you said, they're all wild cards everywhere. But I think if they can win that Georgia game or at least keep it very close toward the end, I'll have a lot of confidence going into the rest of the season. But at the same time, it's the Pac-12. Early in the season is not the end of the season, as we saw, this past year in 21.
Well, and like we just talked about, I mean, you might be in a situation where you start Bo Nix, you play a decent game against Georgia, but you lose. You win the second game against Eastern Washington, and then you find yourself in a real battle against BYU, and maybe you lose against BYU. I mean, I don't think any of the Pac-12 schools thought they were going to lose to BYU this last year, and they all did. You could easily find yourself in the situation we just talked about where now you're putting Ty Thompson in. And the Bo Nix experiment didn't go very well. I mean, if that goes down, wow, Twitter Spaces is going to be electric.
No kidding. Yeah. I mean, I remember being in this Twitter spaces when they got Bo Nix, and it was just the highs and the lows of just the
Exactly.
reaction, like, oh, he's gonna be, he's gonna take us to the championship. Oh, he's gonna be worse than Anthony Brown. It was just this crazy, an atmosphere. Like, how do I feel taking in different ideas? But yeah, I mean, you have to think about, like, what would it take for Bo Nix to be replaced after what we saw from Anthony Brown, where, other coaches, I feel like, probably would have taken out Anthony Brown after a couple of those games, right? The Salt Lake City game, even the Pac-12 championship. I kind of came into the Alamo Bowl, like, I don't feel like they would play Anthony Brown, where they have an interim coach. Joe Moorhead's coming back one last game. You want to get these young guys some experience. Anthony Brown's not necessarily, probably going to be an NFL draft pick, all the respect to him, but I don't think he would be a guy that, has to play one more game to prove anything for his NFL draft stock. So why not put in, a young guy like Thompson? So I'm wondering what it would take for Bo Nix to come in if he's starting, for him to potentially be replaced after what we saw last year.
Yeah, I mean, the loyalty of that Mario Cristobal staff might be different than the Dan Lanning staff. I don't know.
Right.
I feel like, and maybe they need to talk to these guys up front and say, hey, this is the situation. There might be a platooning. If the thing doesn't go off like we want it to, there's going to be a switch. I mean, these guys all need to be transparent of what's going on in the room, but it's going to be a wild year. I mean, you could technically start the year 1-3. Going into a Washington State game up at Pullman to start Pac-12 play, which is dicey. Going up to Pullman any time of the year is not good. Luckily, it's the end of September. It'll still be nice up there, but Pullman is a wild spot. They get rolling. You get a touchdown down up there, and that's the loudest stadium in the whole freaking Pac-12, basically, 30,000 people. And then you have to come back here for a rematch with Stanford, the team that's constantly been a thorn in your side. And again, then you go to the Arizona game that you're thinking could be a trap. So this is by far a very dangerous situation, and you haven't even got into the worst part of your schedule yet, which is at the very end. So again, I think this is one that Duck fans better buckle up for, because again, people have high hopes. The Twitter spaces were saying we wanted whoever the coach is going to bring us the national championship. That's who you want. Oh, that is that who you want? Oh, okay. Okay, we'll just get the one coach then we know can bring us the national champ. Like it's that easy. Are you joking? Like isn't every school looking for that same coach? Like did I miss something? Like, and I think the only one you can do that with that you can guarantee is Saban. I even Kirby Smart. It's like seriously. Anyway, we could talk about that forever. I do think it's going to be an interesting year. There's a lot to talk about. People are excited about the Ducks, and we love having you on. Let's go. Where can we see you? Where can your stuff? Where can Duck fans check you out on Twitter or the anywhere else online?
Absolutely. I appreciate you having me on as always. It's been, I feel like I'm finally part of the Oregon community now, having a video on here with you. I've loved
Yeah.
watching your stuff. Yeah, you can find me on Twitter at DRK Sports News. I'm tweeting Duck stuff all the time. Starting to dive in a little bit into recruiting. So if you're looking for some stuff, follow me over there. Posting stuff on Ducks Digest. So follow us on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook at Ducks Digest. I also work with the Transfer Portal CFB. We're powered by No Context College Football. If you're a fan of that page over there, and so we're gonna have a lot of big stuff coming over the Transfer Portal CFB.com and at T Portal CFB on Twitter.
Nice. Love Max Torres. Love you guys are doing Ducks Digest. It's a great site. That's where I go to get all my information. Max is on it. anything that drops, any news that's happening, he's on it. You guys do a great job over there. So can't thank you guys enough for joining. And let's continue the conversation. Maybe jump back in before the season starts, or obviously with recruiting and everything else. My whole goal is to try to just get more interaction and provide more content for the Duck fans out there, because the Duck fans are hungry.
Absolutely. And I appreciate you being a positive, kind of voice. I know you said you're not part of the media, but I feel like you're definitely a positive voice in that industry. A lot of people look to you for that insight and for those interviews, and you do a great job. So I appreciate you.
I really appreciate that. Yeah, I had Tyson Alger on the other day, and he was like, "You always say you're not media, but you're more media than you think." When I guess when I say the media, I guess that, I'm thinking the dark side of it, right? I'm a fan first. I'm a part of the university, family connection, all those things. So to me, it's like, it's a natural part of it. It's a natural process. I don't have to go out of my realm to talk about the Ducks. That's kind of what I naturally do. So, but I do appreciate what you guys do, the real media folk out there, getting the hard hitting questions and everything else out there. I love the group that we have locally. I think you guys do all a great job and get great information. And I do think it's kind of a color palette. We kind of make fun of sometimes James Crepia, but man, Crepia's been in all those Twitter spaces. He's been in there consistently, giving serious facts. And I can guarantee you Canzano would not be on that level, 100%. So, again, I just think that there's a lot of people out there trying to get information and trying to give the information to the people as best they can. And I think we all work together. I've been never in any way, shape, or form any sort of competition. I have a very minor page comparatively to other guys out there, but I do get a lot of really positive feedback, and people really do dig the channel. I have people stop me at Duck Games telling me that they love me and stuff, and I think that's great. They take pictures of me. They'll, like, have their wife wait for me and take a picture, and they'll be like, "This guy, I'm with this guy." And the wife's like, "That's the guy on YouTube, right?" So I think it's hilarious, but it's a fun time. Duck community is going to be absolutely lit, and we are fired up for this Georgia game. I think, going into this year, I didn't expect I don't have the same sort of connection with the first game that I do with the bowl games. I want to always go to the bowl games, but those first games, I don't necessarily have the same love affair for. My family has a beach house out in Rockaway. That's usually Labor Day weekend. That's usually one of the nicest weekends of the entire year at the beach. And it's like, I could be on the deck or in an airport somewhere going to a game. Now, this one's a little different based on the fact that this stadium is like a freaking absolute spaceship. One, Atlanta's a big draw. Nick Cody has told me for numerous times that the wings are great down there. The other thing is just to understand the connection with this team and Dan Lanning and having that connect. The storyline is too good. So I think coming off of the last year, coming off of COVID, wanting to get back together, I think this is just too much of an opportunity to miss. I think it's a absolute can't miss. And to get to this game is not that expensive. Tickets for the game look pretty expensive. But if you get them to the university, hopefully they won't be as expensive. But still, getting down there, not that expensive.
And if I, if I'm able to get there, I'll probably be up in the press box. But definitely, I'd love to link up. I know everybody likes to come to you and, try to get some pictures with you. And I'm sure you'll be recognized down there in Atlanta, even, thousands of miles away. So, I would love to go. It's not set in stone just yet. I know I'm pretty sure Max will be there if everything goes well. So I'd love to make that trip as well. That would be a blast, win or a loss.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, so we'll rally up. But hey, can't thank you enough, Dylan. Again, appreciate the heck out of what you guys do over there. So again, thanks so much, and we'll talk soon, man.
Of course, man. Thank you so much for having me.
All right, adios.